geoengineering issue, which the Trump administration is also, by the way, doubling down on. Look that one up on geoengineeringwatch.org. Trump administration geoengineering. Look it up. They're backing it. Even though they claim there's nothing wrong with the climate, they're backing climate engineering. Why? Because there's much more to climate engineering than climate engineering. Climate engineering is also weather warfare. By definition, it is weather warfare from bottom to top, and biological warfare, because the elements are toxic, all of which we're breathing. Lab tests prove that. Again, moving on, the geoengineering subject, countless articles in geoengineering are now being published on a daily basis all over the globe. Here's an example from the International Business Times, published a few days ago. Artificially cooling Earth by mimicking volcanic eruptions could be catastrophic, study states from that report. Again, all mainstream sources pretending the elephant in the sky of climate engineering is not really there. We have a society that's all too willing to pretend that as well, because waking up is too scary, too painful. But not waking up is going to be even more scary and painful soon if we stay on this course. From this report again, scientists across the world believe that a process called geoengineering, which involves, this is all from the report, which involves imitating the atmospheric conditions after a massive volcanic eruption by artificially injecting aerosols into the atmosphere, can help counter the effects of global warming. But, continuing from the report, a team of researchers have debunked this theory and countered it by saying this process could in turn have devastating effects on global regions that are already prone to tumultuous weather patterns like severe storms and chronic drought. Of course there will be massive, catastrophic downstream effects. There is. There's no could in any of this. And imagine the sort of Orwellian world we live in, when we have scientific panels, groups, organizations still pretending it's not already going on. They're afraid to admit to this for some of the reasons I already cited. If you stand against the military-industrial complex, you will be dealt with immediately and harshly. So I understand the fear from some of these academicians not telling the full truth. This is already going on. The effects are already catastrophic. But imagine the society we live in, which is even more alarming to me in many ways, a society in which can't or won't, is more the correct word, connect the dots. Incredibly visible dots, like the climate engineering in our skies and the sort of programming that goes on with people when you try to get them to simply open their eyes and look up, and their complete reluctance to do so. All the while, the biosphere implosion continues. More headlines along the same lines. This one's from Newsweek, but I'm pointing out that these headlines are everywhere. They're everywhere. How hard could it be to connect the dots for the population if they really wanted to wake up? They need to, and the criminal behavior of the media carries much of the blame here, because we have those in media actually participating in the climate engineering criminal cover-up, and they should be, must be held accountable legally and morally by an awakened population once we get to that point. Here's another headline parallel with the first. Artificially cooling Earth with volcanic eruptions is dangerous. The lack of regulation is deeply concerning. There's not a lack of regulation. There is no regulation, none whatsoever. From this report, a controversial plan to cool down the planet by artificially stimulating volcanic eruptions could have disastrous consequences for Earth, yet there are no laws or regulations to stop any country or private company from deploying such technology. Look at the, if you go to geoengineeringwatch.org and search massive Senate document and read the excerpts we have from that document that specifically state, this is a congressional Senate document that states anyone involved with these programs needs to have complete legal immunity. If this was something for the greater good, would they need complete legal immunity? States it right in this Senate document, 750 pages long, by the way. And goes over many other damning points as well. And the excerpts are there, so you don't have to go through the whole document. You can look at what we've already highlighted out. Just like the immunity that the vaccination companies have. Total immunity. If this was really something for the greater good, would they need total immunity legally? How hard can that be to figure out for the population? This is not about the greater good. Not in the case of geoengineering.
Schemes proposed ranging from zany to pretty low-tech. And they all have to do with getting aerosols into the stratosphere and keeping them there for years and years and years. So, for example, if we used existing technology, if we used aircraft, this would be the equivalent of taking a small airline and just saying, you do nothing but spray aerosols in the stratosphere for the next and decades.
So right there, his first example of using existing technology to put these aerosols into the sky is using jet aircraft. So is it ridiculous to talk about chemtrails in the sky being part of geoengineering? Absolutely not. It's being discussed in a very serious format here in NASA at the Jet Propulsion Lab about how to mitigate climate change, what to do about it, what's being discussed. And he goes on to talk about all the negative consequences that they know can happen from this.
There are a lot of issues. One is it's known from looking at volcanic eruptions and this cooling effect that you get uneven heating and you actually cause drought in some areas. So country A decides to do geoengineering and they cause a drought in country B. You know, the missiles start flying. What happens if we stop it abruptly? If we can't get control of CO2 and we start, you know, injecting stuff in the stratosphere, it's costing us $10 billion a year, and we have an economic meltdown or a natural disaster or a volcano erupts and we can't fly airplanes for a while. What happens if that shield is removed quickly? We rapidly jump up in temperature. Even greater than that is the fact of what we call instability in the system. If you whack a bell, it rings for a while. The concern of the climate system ringing like a bell and being unstable.
But we're going to see this not only has consequences for the environment, but for who gets to control the environment, what that means for global power. Those are some of the most important questions. Now watch what he says here.
And there are other issues. What about weaponization? If you grew up watching the $6 Million Man and the Bionic Woman like me, and remember there's an episode where the bad guy builds a weather machine and he's, you know, holding all the governments hostage. Well, this is not science fiction anymore. It really could work. Not to mention the distraction of spending cost and who are, and then again, arguments over the thermostat. Whose hands on the thermostat, right? Look how hard it is to get international agreements on anything.
They know it can do everything from cause drought to cause global disagreements. It can empower a rogue individual to unilaterally control the atmosphere, maybe plan out a Dr. Strangelove or James Bond kind of mad scientist hostage situation.
If it's perceived to be cheap and effective, then in the words of Dr. Strangelove, it merely requires the will of trying this, right? And the perception of this could lead to unilateral action. And don't take my word for it. Listen to the World Economic Forum. Every year they put out a risk assessment. Just a couple of weeks ago they put out a risk assessment and they listed 5 wild cards or X factors for the 21st century. Rogue geoengineering was one of those. This is the economist and the business leaders worrying about somebody taking rogue action.
He literally said from NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratories that a legitimate concern is the weaponization of geoengineering. What happens if a mad scientist holds the planet hostage? I'm just going to play it again.
So what about weaponization? The bad guy builds a weather machine and he's, you know, holding all the governments hostage. Well, this is not science fiction anymore.
That's right. The top globalists are worried about unilateral action with geoengineering because they know testing is underway. They count on the public's ignorance, and we're stuck debating whether or not geoengineering is going on, whether or not the chemtrail phenomenon is really what the conspiracy theorists think it is. And here's NASA talking about, we're concerned about rogue geoengineers. We're concerned about a mad scientist hostage situation. We're worried about the Dr. Strangeloves who work partially in private sector, partially inside secret parts of the government.
Weather modification programs, experimental ones done by private companies, done by the United States government, done by states across the United States, are underway. There's more than 50 of them in operation across the United States. None of these programs that I know of today, and this is all public record, are available at any time with oversight, agricultural oversight or public oversight. These programs impact agriculture, and there are programs around the world, international corporations,
and the economy
are modifying our weather all the time.
The policy is there. The ideas of using albedos, solar radiation management for geoengineering are there. But who's involved? Well, here's the Business Insider talking about the CIA wanting to control weather through geoengineering. And once something like geoengineering goes through secret channels of government, once it becomes a matter of national security, the public's ability and, quote, right to know goes straight down the tubes. And we see as well that indeed the CIA is co-sponsoring geoengineering studies, and so are a lot of private individuals. The CFR has been talking about since 2008 the issues with unilateral geoengineering and the consequences of rogue individuals taking hold of the technology.
Geoengineering is also destroying the ozone layer. And this is not conjecture, it's not theory, it's not speculation. Rather, it's verifiable fact. Though mainstream sources are still not acknowledging the climate engineering reality, the catastrophic truth can't be hidden much longer. How many mainstream media sources covered the severe ozone depletion story? Ozone depletion is also occurring all over the globe. Though this depletion is most profound over the polar regions, the impacts are, as already stated, global and getting worse by the day. The now extreme UV radiation is literally frying and killing trees. The damage is most visible where there is the most exposure to the sun. Different species have various levels of resistance to the rapidly increasing UV radiation levels, which includes UVC, the last band of UV radiation before X-ray. But the signs of the UV radiation damage are everywhere and easy to see for anyone that takes the time to notice. Rapidly increasing lightning is yet another firestorm factor that's directly connected to the climate engineering operations. The atmospheric saturation of electrically conductive materials greatly increases the static charge of the atmosphere and thus creates an easier pathway for cloud-to-ground lightning strikes. Though mainstream sources continue to blame increased lightning on planetary warming, the warming itself is not the primary causal factor for the lightning increase. Geoengineering is. The heavy metal particulate fallout from climate engineering operations is coating forests, homes, rooftops, and everything in between. One of the primary elements...